Okay, good afternoon, everybody. My name is Alexander Cooley. I am professor and chair of the political science department at Barnard College here at Columbia University. I'm also deputy director of the Harriman Institute in charge of social sciences public policy programming. It is my great pleasure on behalf of Columbia University's Center on Global Energy Policy and the Harriman Institute to introduce today's speaker, Professor and Minister Yanis Maniatis. Yanis Maniatis is the Minister of Environment, Energy, and Climate Change of the Hellenic Republic. He was elected as a member of the Greek Parliament for the prefecture of Argolida for the PASOK party for the first time in 2004 elections and then re-elected subsequently four times. He was appointed Minister of Environment, Energy, and Climate Change on June 25th of 2013 after holding various positions in the government. I also want to mention it's a great pleasure to have him here because not only is he an influential policymaker, he is also a professor and an academic. He is a rural and surveying engineer by trade, graduating from the National Technical University of Athens. He has been an associate professor at Aristotle University of Thessaloniki since 1995, an associate professor at the University of Piraeus since 2002, and a visiting professor of the Institute of Economic Geography at the University of Bonn 1995. And his main academic fields include geographic information systems, GIS, energy and transportation systems, and environmental monitoring. So he has published more than 80 scientific papers in international congresses and scientific magazines. So it really is a pleasure to have him here. He will be addressing a topic today that both the Energy Center and Harriman have devoted a lot of attention to this year, which is energy security and energy relations. And he'll be bringing a perspective on the Eastern Mediterranean and European energy landscape trends and opportunities. Please join me in welcoming Professor and Minister Yanis Maniatis.
Thank you very much, Alex. Ladies and gentlemen, it's a privilege for me to be here with you. It's really an honor and pleasure to be here at the prestigious Columbia University to give a talk about my countries and about the European energy policy. To add a personal note, coming from academia myself makes me proud that I have the chance to give this talk in a well-known academic establishment, even though I'm here with my other hat, my other capacity, the capacity of a minister. Today I will talk to you about Europe's energy security, highlighting in the contribution of the Greek state. Of course, this notion has a radically different meaning to different people. However, Americans and Europeans share a common vision of energy security based on competitive, diversified, and transparent international energy markets and decisive action on climate change. On both sides of the Atlantic, prosperity relies on stable and competitive energy supply. Interdependent energy markets and our endeavors to ensure free access to multiple markets and reduce import dependence is inevitably a geopolitical question. Today, the term energy independence is popular, but I don't believe it reflects the reality we live in. An energy disruption anywhere will threaten economic growth everywhere. Therefore, it is in the common global interest to have adequate and diverse energy supplies. This is critical for our economies, our security, and for the global prosperity. In this respect, let me remind you the words of Winston Churchill, made on the eve of World War I as First Lord of the Admiralty, and Winston Churchill said, quotes, "Safety in oil lies in variety, and variety alone." These words are as relevant today as they were 100 years ago. The only difference is that this is no longer just about oil. Now the key to energy security is diversification of all energy sources, including through climate policies, and this is the foundation of our energy strategy. For Greece and the European Union, the well-being of our people, industry, and economy depends on safe, secure, sustainable, and affordable energy. However, the European Union's excessive dependence on imports erodes the capacity to deliver on this. Therefore, the consensus in Europe, which Greece passionately promotes, is that energy security goes hand in hand with becoming a competitive, low-carbon society with greater reliance on domestic resources. And we are committed to this. We cannot continue entrusting the fate of our economy and our standard of living on energy sources and external events beyond our control. In contrast to America, Europe is increasingly dependent for a large, I would say for too large, share of its energy. And as events today remind us, global markets many times are not stable. We are living in especially troubled times. As the Ukrainian crisis shows, the great game of geopolitics has returned. Let's have a look around the area of Mediterranean, around Greece, from Libya up to Syria and Iraq. In all these countries, these are above all events of human malaise, pain, and sorrow, but they also seriously implicate energy security. Despite all this, Greece, which is a strategically located country on the crossroads between East and West, is an anchor of stability in the middle of a rapidly destabilizing region. An EU and NATO member, Greece is working to generate synergies among different countries in the Eastern Mediterranean and promote peace, security, and regional cooperation. In this context, bilateral relations with Israel at the energy sector have been strategically intensified to function as a factor of regional stability. Moreover, I am traveling to Israel shortly to sign a trilateral agreement on the environment with my counterparts from Cyprus and Israel. Regarding recent Turkish illegal and aggressive attitude contesting the Republic of Cyprus' lawful right to exploit its national resources, the European Council could not have been more clear on the 24th of October, according to its final resolution. Quotes, the European leaders express serious concern about the renewed tensions in the Eastern Mediterranean and urge Turkey to show restraint and respect Cyprus' sovereignty over its territorial sea and Cyprus' sovereign rights in its exclusive economic zone. The European Council also recalled the declaration of the European Community and its member states in 2005, including that the recognition of all member states is a necessary component of the accession process of Turkey. Greece also took note of repeated United States statements calling for the need to respect the Republic of Cyprus' sovereign rights in its exclusive economic zone. Further to the above-mentioned cooperation, we are promoting the so-called Eurasia Interconnector, a submarine cable to link the Israeli, Cypriot, and Greek power grids, a historic project endorsed, financed by the European Union. Let me share with you a further recent geopolitical development which offers rich opportunities. The trilateral cooperation between Greece, Cyprus, and Egypt. Following much preparation, we look forward for the first trilateral summit of heads of state and government level this week in Cairo. Our hope is our initiatives, which are in no way directed against any third party, to create regional beacons of light and serve as a model for regional dialogue. This is what we are striving to achieve, and energy is a vital element to this process. Now, the Greek economy has been under the spotlight for some time. Much gloom has been cast about Greece's prospects. So, before I discuss energy issues, I will briefly update you on our economy. 2014 is the year Greece goes out of the crisis. After 6 years of recession, the Greek economy returned to growth in the third quarter of 2014 and is expected to have positive growth on an annual basis. We have managed to achieve, way ahead and above expectations, a primary fiscal surplus. In other words, we learned to live with what we earn. In 2015, our total fiscal deficit, even after debt interest payments, will be completely eliminated. As a result of lower interest rates, the Greek state, together with the banking system and major Greek corporations, have regained access to the international capital market. In short, during the past 3 years, we achieved the largest fiscal adjustment and at the shortest period of time. We did this despite an adverse environment of doomsday scenarios that usually work as self-fulfilling prophecies. In parallel, we implemented immense structural reforms. In just 2 years, we climbed 111 positions in the global rankings of competitiveness of the International Bank from position 147 to the position 36. Accordingly, in the World Bank's Doing Business 2015 index, Greece is now 61st among 189 countries. Today, we are in a position where we can change the policy emphasis from austerity to development. Our goal is to make Greece a friendly and attractive country for foreign direct investment. The energy sector can be crucial, attracting investments and creating jobs. Ladies and gentlemen, Europe's energy security problems can be summed up in two words: excessive dependence. To understand Europe's situation, which is so different from America's, let's remember a few facts. With 53% of the energy consumed coming from abroad, the EU is the world's largest importer of energy. This dependency is 80% for crude oil, 66% for natural gas, and 40% for nuclear fuel. Some states in the less integrated Baltic and East European regions are especially vulnerable. Greece's portfolio, on the other hand, is diversified, with 67% of imports coming from Russia, 17% from Azerbaijan on the basis of a Turkish contract, and 16% coming from Algeria. In fact, we are the first EU state to import Azeri gas. I stress, however, that import dependence challenges the entire European Union, not just the most affected states. Dependency on gas imports is rising for the European Union as a whole by 10% since the mid-90s and will continue rising. Moreover, this dependence comes at a high cost going beyond securing supplies. First, this dependence is a financial burden. The EU's external energy bill represents more than 1 billion euros per day. More than 1 billion euros per day. And more than a fifth of total European imports. And it is too much. Second, it undermines competitiveness. Growing energy demand in emerging economies increasingly diverts supplies away from Europe, puts pressure on prices, and poses a serious threat to industrial competitiveness of the whole European industry infrastructure. Third, it restricts the EU's role as a force, as a reliable force in foreign affairs issues. These aspects, plus declining domestic production, highlight Europe's vulnerability. If anybody had any doubts, the Ukrainian crisis again awakened our fears of supply disruptions. Clearly, business as usual is no longer viable. And it seems that we are lucky because last week we had a deal among the European Union, Ukraine, and Russia. This new deal eases concerns that Europe would face an energy crisis this winter. But Europe cannot count on last-minute deals. Its problems are not short-term, and nor are they caused by Ukraine. Gradually, and I could say too gradually, a common energy security strategy has evolved to reduce external dependence. For Greece and for the European Union, this strategy concerns four major challenges. Namely, one, to diversify sources and routes. Second, to develop an integrated internal market. Third, to save energy and transit to a lower carbon society. And fourth, to increase domestic production. These four components are vital. A safe, secure, sustainable, and affordable energy supply is the key to Europe's economic and strategic interests. We are in a transition, but a lot has already been achieved. First, regarding diversification of EU's hopes, which have mostly focused on Caspian resources. In this respect, the final investment decision from the consortium of the gas field Shah Deniz 2 in 2013 was an historic decision, a milestone in the EU's 20-year effort to develop the Southern Corridor through Trans-Adriatic Pipeline, through TAP, and to connect Caspian gas to Europe's markets. The 10 billion cubic meters, the 10 BCM, destined for Europe via the Trans-Anatolian, TANAP, a Trans-Adriatic Pipeline, TAP, and the future increase from 10 to 20 BCM in the long run, sent the right message to all directions. Strategically, the opening of the Southern Gas Corridor is more important than any other number. TAP, which extends from near the Turkish-Greek border to Italy, has three basic characteristics. One, it creates a new route for Europe in addition to North Sea, North Africa, and Russia routes. Two, enables the entry of a major new supplier, the Azeri company Sokar. And three, interconnects Southeast Europe with Central Europe's major grids and hubs. Greece's role in Europe's diversification strategy is crucial. It is the EU's gateway to the Southern Corridor, to the Caucasus and the Middle East, and the largest part of TAP runs through the country. We have supported this project at every step and are committed to its completion. In September, I approved the environmental impact assessment for the Greek section, as with the other hat, the hat of the Minister of Environment, completing so a vital step towards the project's realization. When it begins operating in late 2019, Europe's energy security will be decidedly enhanced. Europe's goal is at the same time to further expand the Southern Corridor. We have a significant opportunity right on our doorstep in the Eastern Mediterranean, including in the exclusive economic zone of Cyprus and Israel. According to the United States Geological Survey, in East Mediterranean, there may be up to 3,500 billion cubic meters of recoverable offshore gas, while 1.5 billion barrels of oil are estimated. With such resources, this region can become a plank of energy security for Europe. And again, Greece's role is prominent. A bridge linking the region to the EU's markets. In this context, we are promoting the East Mediterranean pipeline, stretching from the offshore fields to continental Europe via Cyprus and Greece. Pre-feasibility studies show that this project is economically and technically feasible, similar to the Medgas pipeline between Algeria and Spain. Above all, this project creates a completely new route for Europe in addition to the Caspian route via Turkey. This, in my opinion, is its priceless added value for Europe's energy security. Let's remember that diversification is about new and safe supply routes, not just for new sources. Diversification has to do with new sources and new routes. Assessing LNG is also a priority and essential during a crisis. In 2009, Greece was protected because we are lucky to have Ravithousa. Ravithousa is an island, you can see it on the picture, is an island near Athens. The only LNG terminal in EU's Balkan area. Besides Ravithousa, we were able to supply Bulgaria with critical supplies during the worst moments of 2009. Recognizing its strategic importance, the European Union is supporting financially the current upgrading of this invaluable terminal. We are upgrading in about 75% of its total capacity. We strongly believe Greece as an entry point for LNG is by far the most cost-effective option for augmenting energy security in Southeast Europe well before 2020. Our state-of-the-art Ravithousa LNG terminal has an excellent record of reliability, safety, and also affordability. Ravithousa has an excess regasification capacity of 4 plus BCM, more than 4 BCM per year, similar with the excess capacity of the proposed interconnector between Greece and Bulgaria, the so-called IGB interconnector, if we exclude the 1 BCM per year, 1 billion cubic meters per year, that Bulgaria is expected to receive from TAP. The existence of such an excess capacity simply means that LNG arriving at Ravithousa feed the IGB and through it our northern neighbors with extra gas. In 2016, excess capacity in the existing Greek LNG terminal is estimated to be 6 BCM per year due to an upgrade program of 160 million euros, which is underway. Unlike other planned alternatives in other regions of southeastern Europe, Revithoussa already has an operational record of more than 400 ships. Hence, the Greek LNG terminal coupled with IGB and at least one floating storage and regasification unit in northern Greece can fill the gap with a minimum of capital expenditure compared to any other project. Europe faces acute competition from Asia, but is looking to increase LNG supplies. Turning now to challenge number two, to develop an integrated internal market. Let me tell you this. If during the 2009 crisis, the internal market had been completed with the necessary infrastructure to transport gas where needed, nobody would have stayed in the cold. Where markets work and are well connected, little space remains to use energy as a political tool. The crisis in Ukraine confirms the importance of an integrated market. Who is most at risk? The countries whose energy systems are isolated, physically, technically, and from a regulatory perspective. Overcoming this is largely what the internal market is about. The key to this is to build the necessary interconnections among the national grids and to implement rules guaranteeing non-discriminatory access to independently operated infrastructure. And of course, to promote hub pricing and enable the market to deliver reliable price signals for efficient production and investment decisions. With breakthrough legislation known in Europe as the third energy package, the EU has progressed towards an integrated and transparent market. But we need more reverse flow interconnections to ensure that once diversified sources enter Europe, they can be delivered anywhere. And this is the key to success. To promote this pan-European vision, we identified strategic projects with the European Project of Common Interest label, known as PCIs, Projects of Common Interest. And you can see on this picture the more important projects of common interest in Greece. The fact that 12 projects of common interest relate to Greece reveals its importance to Europe's energy security and its prospects as a transit and pricing hub in an integrated Southeast European market. Greece's choice of project is not random. They promote our vision to become a hub in an integrated Southeast European energy market. The Greek-Bulgaria interconnector constitutes a gateway to Southeastern and Central Europe. You can see the two lines on the north of the picture. This is the Greek-Bulgarian interconnector. Working in synergy with TAP and the regional infrastructure, the IGB can potentially deliver gas right up to Hungary. We consider developing a vertical axis south to north, also known as the Central Gas Corridor, and this will connect our LNG import terminals with Bulgaria, Romania, Hungary, and possibly even Serbia and the Baltic Sea. This corridor was called in its first steps as a Chin-Baltic corridor. But for the time being, according to the maturity of the discussions, of the debate among the countries, we have started at this first phase to interconnect the national grids between Greece, Bulgaria, Romania, and Hungary. Via Greece and the IGB, Southeast Europe gains exposure to major European markets and hubs, to the conditions which foster flexible markets and competitively priced energy, so essential to their energy security. The two PCIs regarding a floating storage and regasification unit in the Northern Aegean also contributes to market development by providing access to even more diversified supplies. And you can see on the image one of the two floating LNGs, floating storage and regasification units co-financed by the European Union. And this is the other one, the other floating LNG. Challenge number three, to develop a low-carbon society which is more relevant than ever. The Ukrainian crisis confirmed this. Would it not be wise to reduce dependence and its cost by saving and producing energy in Europe? Wouldn't Ukraine be less vulnerable if it consumed less? Currently, its energy intensity, I'm talking about Ukraine, is 10 times the OECD average. On the contrary, the European Union has made important progress. It has the lowest energy intensity of all world regions and the highest demand for renewable energy. Greece is also contributing to Europe's push to develop new sources of hydrocarbons. And this is the final challenge, challenge number four. Remarkably, Greece remains one of the most underexplored and yet promising countries when it comes to oil and gas fields. Why this is the case is a rather complex issue. What matters now is that after 15 years of putting this issue aside, a new chapter for Greece's hydrocarbons has started. And you can see on the image that all over the Mediterranean countries, there are dark dots. In Greece, you have no dark dot, which means that for the last 20 years, nobody has drilled anywhere. And we are changing now this case. Since 2010, we have implemented a new strategy and new policy tools to unlock our national oil and gas potential. I am therefore excited, and it is one of my personal priorities, to be at the helm of taking forward Greece's new horizons for hydrocarbon exploration. It is important to underline, despite all other details, that Greece now possesses a transparent and simple legal framework which integrates the latest trends and the best international practices for concession rights. In addition to the above, we have a very favorable corporate tax, which has been lowered from 40% to 20%. We have also an efficient and newly established authority, the Hellenic Hydrocarbons Resources Management Company. We also have strict EU environmental regulations. And finally, and last, the largest commercial fleet in the world. Most importantly, we have the vote of confidence by the industry itself. Ladies and gentlemen, dear friends, at the end, Europe cannot realistically achieve full energy independence. However, excessive energy dependence undermines economic and political independence. Overcoming this is critical to our security and economy. This is why Europe shares America's commitment to ensure free access to markets and strategic resources, and why NATO has identified energy security as the key security issue of our time. Our hope is that the reserves of Eastern Mediterranean will serve as a catalyst for regional cooperation and contribute to peace and stability. It's challenging, but with political will, energy can create cooperation. This is the benchmark of Greece's energy diplomacy in Europe and the East Mediterranean. Energy challenges are global. Obviously, we can address them more effectively by stressing our interdependence and working collectively. This is essential for our prosperity, for our peace, for our stability, and for our strength. This is essential for the welfare of our communities. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you very much indeed, Minister. And we'll now move to the discussion part of our program. And you should all have some cards, some note cards on your chair. So if you would like to ask a question, please write a brief question, and then those will be collected and sent up here. And I just have a couple of points just to start the conversation. I was very much struck by the synergies between the Greek energy security strategy that you've laid out and the emerging EU goals and policies. And the two seem very much to be congruent, to be in sync. And Greece has coped and tackled so many important challenges over the last years, the financial crisis, now the Ukraine crisis. In your opinion, has the Ukraine crisis, has it taught you any new lessons about energy security, or has it reinforced these strategic objectives that you've had before and emphasized how important they are?
I hope that the European leaders have learned their lesson, because the societies, the economy, the players of the real economy have learned the lesson. And if I can interpret the last resolution, the last document on the conclusions of the European Council, Europe has understood that for the benefit of the European societies, the 28 member states and the Union as an international entity, a total international personality, should take measures, not at the last, at the last time. We need to have short-term, medium-term, and long-term measures. I strongly believe that I did not show you a picture on all the projects of common interest in Europe, which have to do with both electricity, mainly electricity, and natural gas. One of the main principles of these projects is the development of infrastructure, especially at the approach of interconnecting already existing national grids. And this is one of the key factors if we want to have more energy security. At the same time, I think that all the consumers, and I'm talking about the big consumers, the big electricity companies, because they are the big natural gas consumers, have understood that their future depends on a reliance of as more as possible indigenous European sources. And this is why Greece has started to promote its own national activity on developing, on exploiting and exploring natural resources, hydrocarbons in Ionian Sea, mainly offshore Ionian Sea and Crete. Finalizing, trying to summarize, I think that now The European governments have understood that energy dependence is like political dependence. Mm. It is so important for the competitiveness of the European industry. But at the same time, it affects the daily living of all European households that they have decided to take concrete decisions. And this is why the Southern Corridor, TAP, has its importance not just as a real project, but also it has its symbolic importance as a new source and a new route for providing natural gas to Europe. I think so.
Very
to answer, I think I'm sure that the European political elite has learned the lesson.
Now, one of the striking parts of your presentation was painting this very bold vision of the East Mediterranean pipeline and its potential to both diversify energy resources and create new connections. And of course, we all hope that pipelines can be a source for cooperation and stability as opposed to political competition. What do you think are some of the main issues that need to be engaged with or resolved to make sure that the vision of the East Mediterranean contributes to promoting regional cooperation and stability as opposed to competition? What are some of the challenges, as you might see them, to the project?
Well, I think that these two trilateral cooperation schemes, one between Greece, Cyprus, and Israel, at sectors like energy, tourism, culture, and other issues, mm-hmm. which connects the three societies, the three economies. And the other regional cooperation between Greece, Cyprus, and Egypt sent the message of cooperation, stability, peace, and the message that some countries want prosperity for their societies, for their peoples. I strongly believe that talking about Mediterranean countries, and of course about all the other European countries, such inclusive, not exclusive, cooperation efforts should be examples of how we can manage our present and our future lives. I want to repeat once more that these two trilateral cooperation schemes are inclusive. Nobody is excluded. These cooperation are not against any third party. Everybody accepting the international law, accepting the values and principles of peace, are welcomed to this cooperation. I think this is the message.
Yeah. Now, take a question from the audience. Thank you. You mentioned that the internal market in the EU is one of also contained in the energy strategy of Greece itself. And the question is, how do you think nationalism and or protectionism within the EU would impact that? If there's another crisis, would solidarity among EU states remain?
Thank you very much for this question, Alex. May I ask, now talking about solidarity in the European Union, which is one of the principles of the existence of the European Union, we can see solidarity in various aspects of public life. But we have not yet seen this at the energy sector. 3 or 4 months ago, me as the Greek Minister of Energy sent a letter to the European Commissioner and to the Italian presidency, asking in the framework of the principle of solidarity, of European solidarity, to formulate an umbrella. Talking about umbrella, I'm talking about an information system and a financing instrument, both, in order, in case of crisis, to keep LNG, additional energy cargos, in Europe for the use of the most affected countries. So the idea was that in such cases, for short periods, for 1, 2, 3 months, the 28 member states and the European Commission, as another independent institution, decision-making body in the European Union, should formulate, should establish this information system on not necessary LNG cargos, for example, let's say in Portugal, in Spain. Mm. Portugal, Spain, Ireland will not be affected by any Ukrainian crisis. Mm. On the other side, Greece, Bulgaria, Romania, Hungary will be affected. It's due to the geography. So the idea was to establish this such a mechanism. Besides the information platform, my proposal was to develop a financial instrument. Somebody should pay something more, because in case of crisis, the LNG prices, the price of the cargos, are increasing. So we have discussed it at the Council of Ministers. The decision has not yet been taken. But at the lower level, under the ministers, the experts have come to concrete resolutions, to concrete results, which give us we are sure now that such a mechanism can be implemented. So we have gone some steps forward. We have not implemented the system, but in any case, this solidarity approach has started to be implemented.
Interesting. And from the European Union to an interesting question about Greece, if I may. And the question says, ever think of the many islands, 500 plus of them, as micro-energy grids using all renewables, such as wind, solar, and storage? El Hierro in Spain's Canary Islands has done 100% renewable this way. Do you have a specific way of thinking about the energy challenges of all of your islands?
Well, thanks. Thanks. Honestly talking, thanks for this question. Interconnecting the Greek islands with mainland is one of the major projects in Greece. I call it the total approach as the Greek mega project. We are spending each year for the production of power, of electricity, in all the Greek islands, more than 600 or 700 million euros each year for oil, for fuels. Of course, interconnecting all these islands has concrete, severe sometimes, technical problems. Mm. But having in mind the potential in wind and solar energy, and knowing that you are spending as a society, as an economy, about 600 or 700 thousand euros, you should do something. So 2.5 years ago we started, and now we are implementing the first interconnection of a complex of islands. It's a part of the Kyklades complex. This project has a total budget of about 240 million euros. This is a project there with contractors. We have passed to the second phase for the rest of Ireland. There is a great challenge for the interconnection between the island of Crete with mainland. It's a project of a total cost of about 1 billion euros, but we have started with all the necessary studies. I suppose that in 1 or in less than 2 years, there we will have available all the necessary technical studies in order to start implementing also this this interconnection. But I think that the fact that we have lived as an economy for the last 3-4 decades with no interconnection between our islands is one of the comparative disadvantages of tourism, of the inhabitants of the islands, of whatsoever. But we have started to change, to turn the corner, and this is one of our challenges.
Great, thank you. And then a very final question. This one is via Twitter, so we're on social media now. Would there ever be competition between Europe and the Middle East and their needs for gas, going even more macro? Do you ever envision between Europe and the Middle East?
Well, according to the last study of the International Energy Agency, we have seen that the Gulf, the East, the even the Gulf countries, the Gulf states, are more consumers than producers. Yeah. And this is the challenging global picture. You have now the States, who is producer, not a big importer, and you have on the other hand Middle East countries of the Gulf, in the Gulf, who have so much consumption that they have started to have a problem. So I think that we are a global economy changing its basic characteristics, and from a political, geopolitical, economic point of view, these are the new challenges the analysts at the energy sector have to face. And of course, these are challenges for the international bodies analyzing the energy trends all over the world. But in any case, I think, if I can summarize, that we must have in mind that diversification in routes and sources, implementing interconnections between among all countries. Third, and I want to pay attention to be careful on this because it's extremely important, energy efficiency and energy savings towards a low carbon economy, which is crucial, as crucial as to discuss about new energy sources. And of course, the integration of the energy market and the development of the indigenous resources are what a country should do towards this direction. Let me say that I think that all the societies have given less importance to energy safety and energy efficiency, energy savings and energy efficiency. And I think that talking in an academic audience, talking to my colleagues, to professors and to students, I could say that energy efficiency and energy savings could be a new huge sector of new jobs, new public revenues, new prosperity for economies and for citizens and for societies, and we should pay much, much more attention to this issue than we have already paid.
Well, wonderful. Well, the minister has covered so much geopolitical ground, European ground, and ground on the islands. It's been truly an engaging and a very informative lecture. Please join me on behalf of the Center on Global Energy Policy here at Columbia University and the Harriman Institute, thanking Minister and Professor Magnatis for this wonderful lecture today. Thank you.